show!
Stranger Things!
Luke Cage.
And an ass ton of more stuff right now on Fat Man on Batman. Welcome to Fat Man on Batman. I'm Kevin Smith.
I'm Mark Bernardin.
We're here to drop all the news that's fit to print.
Or tape.
Yeah.
Or broadcast, or stream.
And to be fair, it's old news by this point, by the time you're hearing it. But it's news to us.
True, and it's less news, it's more views.
That's true.
Some things we've seen.
And that's why you hang out with Mark Bernardin. He's a writer, goddammit. Mark Bernardin, aside from writing comics and TV and shit like that, is an editor. What is your exact title?
Film editor, the LA Times.
Film editor. Did you hear that? Film editor, LA Times. That's the kind of thing you say at a press conference. Mark Bernardin, film editor, LA Times. Where's the bathroom? Like, it's over there, you fucking... You wasted time at a press conference.
But I've got this hat with press stuck in the brim.
And I have to urinate. Thank you. Now to go.
Pardon me.
We are going to talk this week about a bunch of things. We'll do Stranger Things last. Because
yes.
Everyone's been going like, are you ever going to fucking talk about Stranger Things?
Yes.
Today is that day. But before
dreams
that...
Dreams do come true.
Let's talk a little bit about Luke Cage.
Which he and I, you and I, us, we have both seen the first seven episodes of Luke Cage.
Yeah, that's right.
We are prohibited from speaking at length in detail about what
signed
we saw.
Signed end disclosure agreements, non-disclosure agreements, so that we can't say anything to a certain point. But I challenge this NDA by saying this. It is fucking spectacular.
It really is.
There. I mean, sue me now, Arnold.
I'm sorry I told people your thing was good.
It is fucking dynamite. Here, if I have to rank the Marvel Netflix shows so far, and I don't want to, unless somebody's got a fucking gun to my head.
Rank them.
But I'm a comic book fan. We rank shit. Here we go.
Rank
doesn't make one worse than the other. Personal preferences for me.
Rank them up.
Daredevil season one and Luke Cage are almost shoulder to shoulder. That's how much I loved Luke Cage.
Both shows.
Right under that, Jessica Jones. Right under that, Daredevil season two. And that's not to say I didn't like Daredevil season two. I liked it a lot. But Jessica Jones is crazy good quality. It's just a way of saying all of these shows are fucking phenomenal. Luke Cage did not fucking disappoint, man. No. Like, they took a story in a bunch of different unpredictable directions, told it with a filmmaking style that spoke to me as an indie filmmaker. I love the composition. I love the, this is weird, editing. They actually let some scenes go longer than your knee-jerk editor in you would let it, would cut it out. So many scenes where I'm like, oh, they need to go out there. But they let it go on for just a couple seconds more, and I'm like, I like it, it's nuanced. The other thing they did was something that show Vinyl did that I liked, which was like have a musical number in the middle of it, somebody singing. Now in Vinyl, it was like, you know, a flashbacky thing to a famous artist. Here, Cottonmouth, who's the villain, that's not spoiling it, because they've cast that guy and they said that in the news. He has a club in Harlem that people perform at, and he also, his background, well, this is, I can't spoil that, right?
No, not too much.
But he has a club in Harlem where people come perform. So throughout the show, you have like these wonderful performances like on stage that are usually cross-cut with something heinous going on or something thrilling or something, or an action sequence. Really well done, man. The infusion of music is something that, like, you know, every show has had a score. But this brings, you know, by virtue of the fact that their story's set at a club sometimes, they're allowed to like bring in elements that you haven't seen in other Marvel shows. Elements that you have seen in other Marvel shows that are on full display here. S-E-X.
Oh, yeah.
From the first episode, it's just like, pa-cha-kang, pa-cha-cha-cha-chang. His pants get shimmied down. You see a lot of flesh. Oh, my Lord.
Shimmy, shimmy, shimmy down, shimmy pants.
It is, it's pretty, don't watch it with your kid.
No.
Unless you want to be like,
Or unless you wanted to have the talk, and you needed a thing to have the talk about.
Why is Luke uncaged? That's his dick, okay?
That is his super-powered dick.
It is, yeah, there's some sex in it. But that's what I like about these shows. Like Jason Mewes, guy who plays Jade in My Silent Bob, my fucking male wife, said that one point when he was watching Jessica Jones, he goes, I don't watch that no more. And I was like, what do you mean? He's like, I only watch three episodes. I don't watch the rest. I said, why? It's awesome. He goes, it's too sexy. There's too much sex. She's always having sex. And I'm like, why are you intimidated by this? He's like, I don't, that's not what I want in my superheroes. But meanwhile, he's watched Luke Cage, and one of the first things he said was, did you see him knock the bottom out? And I'm like, I thought you didn't like superhero sex. It's not an overuse. In fact, I believe he gets laid in the first episode. Yeah, and then
just the one scene.
Well, like, spoilers, I guess.
But it's the one scene.
Oh, it's hot. But anyway, it's not. I don't want you going like, this is all about sex on Luke Cage. Yeah. But it's sexy. Like, it's sexy. Adult. It's like, if only the universe was smart enough to know Marvel beyond Marvel. Like, if they ever knew of Marvel's epic line, they could have called all the Netflix shows Marvel Epic, because it's just grown up enough. They don't curse. They find a very ingenious way to not fucking curse a lot in the show, and a very sentimental, nostalgic way of working in with a character. Performances are fantastic across the boards. Mike Coulter, we've seen him go to work as Luke Cage in Jessica Jones. Who you haven't seen up till now is Misty Knight. Played by Simone Missick. Like, this is an insanely strong female character that has been around in Marvel Comics forever, but they've now added to the Marvel canon in terms of cinematic universe. I guess the TV is included in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Yep. Like, strong-ass character who could have her own show. In fact, she spends so much time on screen with him, it's almost like their story.
Yeah.
Now, if you know that character from the comics, she's got a rich history, man. Like, you know, spoilers, this don't happen in the series. I'm talking about comic books now. But Misty Knight, like, loses her arm. She gets a bionic arm that Tony Stark builds for her and shit. And she goes on to date who? Not Luke Cage, but
Daniel Rand.
Spoilers. Iron Fist. She gets Iron Fisted. Can you believe that shit?
Like, so she's got the metal arm.
Yeah, maybe she's got. He's getting Iron Fisted. He's like, that's why they call me that. Ooh, that's why I wear the scarf to keep my brains in when I get Iron Fisted by my girl with the bionic arm. That's why they don't let us do these shows. And now they're not going to let us watch these shows anymore either.
So you want to watch the first seven? No. No, you can't.
Oh my God. It was. I binged. I went one after the other, man. Just boom, 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 boom,
and
boom.
And it's got a great sense of place. Yeah. Like, you absolutely know.
I mean, community.
Previously, we had seen, like, Hell's Kitchen be kind of Hell's Kitchen-y. This is fucking Harlem.
Yeah, it's uptown. They reference that all the time. They're like, there's some weird things going on downtown.
But up in Harlem, we take care of our own. Mm. And Harlem is totally a character here. And it's definitely, like, the texture of it feels like it feels real. And it is the blackest show I've seen in a long time.
Even more than Black-ish?
Even more than Black-ish, it's black. It's the
like, if Black-ish is Black-ish,
yeah,
this is just flat out black.
This is new black.
It's, yeah, but not in like black. Don't fucking scare what's left of old white America that ever is watching this. It's awesome.
It's awesome, but it's awesome the way The Wire is awesome. And The Wire.
And they cherry picked The Wire cast wise, smartly.
Smartly, but
it is. It's kind of like Marvel does The Wire.
It's Marvel does The Wire, and it feels very much like that. And I know you old white guys love The Wire, so you will also love this.
There you go. That was a good way in. Listen, old white folks, remember how thrilled you were by The Wire? It's just like that.
It's just like The Wire.
Except he's bulletproof, which is fucking fantastic. That's whenever they do a fight sequence, he's just like, and people go flying and shit.
It's the nonchalance. It's just the like. You bother me. Like, okay, fine. I've got to destroy you dozen people again.
Throwing people into ceilings, through windows. Right. They have a, you know, like in Daredevil, the hallway fight and stuff. They have their version of it. It's not so much a one long take, but it's Luke. You've seen it in the trailer. Luke entering a place and just decimating.
With the car door pulls off and he's just a battering ram and it's ripping pipes out of the wall and it's so great.
There's lots of that. There's a shot. God, fuck, I want to talk about it so bad. But there's something straight out of the comic books. Straight, like in a lot of character names are and stuff. And the performances, top fucking notch. Alfred Woodard kills. Who's the guy who's playing Cottonmouth? I can't pronounce his name.
Mahalal Shabazz Ali.
I always say that's the dude from House of Cards. Mm-hmm. He's fantastic as Cottonmouth. Like, honestly, he's one of the most compelling villains that Marvel's put together. This is my theory about the Marvel Cinematic Universe. The best villains are on their Netflix shows because you got way more time to pull the taffy. Like, think about the Age of Ultron. Mm-hmm. Your motherfucker was like, I just want to stop things. Tony needs to be punished. And no motivation. He's a computer, whatever, fuck. But they got no time because they're like jamming story down your throat, a lot of action. Here with TV shows, when you got 10, 13 episodes, you can pull that taffy out.
Kingpin is great. David Tennant's Purple Man is great. You know, Cottonmouth is great.
Add to that pantheon now, the performance of Cottonmouth. Like, it is nuanced and rich, and also, Alpha. Well, I mean, that's not spoiling, because anybody knows the character. Mariah, like, she's a villain too. In the comics, she's a massive villain. She's big. But here, she's played by Alfred Woodard, who's not very big at all. But who's big in talent, motherfucker, but not big in waste. But she's another villain. She's also the big bad as well. And she is, like, they got fucking lucky getting her in this thing to play the bad guy. Like, she's fantastic, man. Like, I'm telling you, cast across the boards is dynamite.
Yeah, super strong. So, yes. When you can watch, September 30, I believe.
Is that when it comes out?
They all drop. It's a little sneak preview, still in August. Telling you, the inside dope.
It's worth the wait.
It really is.
And you know, you're wondering, well, you've seen from the trailer, the headband and the cuffs play for at least a beat in the origin story, but there's more.
Oh, there's so much more.
Oh, Easter Egg City. It's like Easter when you watch this thing. The eggs just start flying, and you just want to eat them. You know, suck the color off and eat them. That's how you do it, right? That's how you did it in your house, right?
Pretty much, fillet the eggs until all the colors off.
So Luke Cage, man, like, I can't, honestly, my thumbs up, his thumbs up.
Do it.
Andrew's shooting us, his thumbs are up, my thumbs straight up my ass. This show is phenomenal.
Wiggle.
Yeah, and this, honestly, like, of all of them, now I hold out hope for fucking Iron Fist.
I really do.
Because, like, they fucking nailed Luke Cage. Like, it is really enjoyable, man. A lot of people go, like, hey, it's like modern-day blaxploitation. I didn't feel that at all.
No.
It kind of plays more like The Unforgiven.
Yeah,
like, a dude who's like, I'm done with this.
Yeah, The Wire. It's The Wire. It's not blaxploitation. Once again, The Wire.
It is. It's excellent. It's Marvel does The Wire.
Yeah. The Wire was
Does The Wire do Marvel?
Ooh.
Maybe they give each other. Maybe they reciprocate.
We'll reach around.
You go first, and I go.
Marvel's reach around. Luke Cage.
This is why they don't let us title things.
Nope.
Luke Cage, fucking watch it. Put it in your eyeballs.
You know what else I watched on the Netflix?
Tell.
The Get Down.
Ooh, I wanted to see that. This is the Baz Luhrmann does the Origins of Hip Hop thing.
Yes.
Didn't know about the Baz Luhrmann thing until later on, but I just saw the posters. I was in New York, I saw the posters. Holy shit, this looks fucking dope. And then when I saw the trailer, I'm like,
Yes, like 1970s, like mid, like 75, 76 in the Bronx.
I know it's gonna sound crazy to say because I'm like a middle-aged white man, but I feel this was made for me.
You.
Yes!
Absolutely.
It's my era of hip-hop.
I thought about you every time, every episode I watched. It's like, you know what, Kevin would fucking love this.
Does it make you roll a tear?
It does.
Really?
It
I'm in. You just fucking it sold does. Me. If you can fucking get me with the music and shit in that time in my life, but you get me with emotional as well.
I mean, what Baz Luhrmann does almost better than anybody else is capture like adolescent yearning and love and romance and desire and like ambition.
Mm.
He does that almost like nobody else does.
Ah.
And set against this weird, like the recreation of the South Bronx feels arch. Like everything's always on fire. There's always buildings smoking somewhere in the distance. Every train is just littered with graffiti. It kind of doesn't matter because the world is a little bit heightened. But
is it? So there's a bit of like Romeo and Juliet.
A little bit, but like not a ton. But there's definitely a romance between two people in it,
right.
Like kind of at the core of it. And then beyond that, it's the creation of hip hop. It is the, and there's this great beat in the first episode where Grandmaster Flash playing Grandmaster Flash.
How's that possible?
Because black doesn't crack, my friend.
There it is. You just learned it here on Fat Man
here
on Batman.
Now. Like he's playing, he's probably now in his early 50s, is playing probably somebody in his early 20s. And it doesn't matter. You put a Kango on a dude in a nice leather jacket. And
he broke when he was very young.
But he's explaining to a couple of disciples. Kung Fu is a huge part of this thing. So he's
is it really?
Yeah, like the 70s Kung Fu wave. And there's one dude, his name is Shaolin Fantastic.
Ah!
Just call him Shao. And like there's this Shao. But he's explaining exactly what the Get Down is. The Get Down is every disco record has, you know, every song has like 4 minutes of bullshit. Like there's strings and there's singing and whatever. But then there's the drum break. There is like a nice 10, 15 seconds. That's the Get Down beat. That is what the break dancers like to dance to. And so then the DJ's job is to control time and space, is to take that break and through the use of two turntables, extend that break.
Mm.
So you get the like the break and then you mix it together, the break.
To another
and then
break.
The break. And the break. And the break.
And these
the
break, are the breaks. Break it up,
and
break it up, break it up.
Break dancing came from people dancing just during the breaks. And it's all about like how hip hop was born out of nothing. Out of all we have is two turntables and a microphone and we're going to create an art form that previously did not exist, that could not exist without the sort of privation and deprivation and just ingenuity of these dudes who have no instruments, have nothing beyond.
Stop talking, I'm just gonna go watch it right now. My God, you fucking oversold it, that's fantastic. I want it. You watched every episode so far?
I've watched it, they dropped six, and then there's another six coming in 2017.
Really?
Yeah.
So six is not an hour long?
Yeah.
Not
well, the pilot episode is like an hour and a half.
Right.
And the pilot episode is, I will say, a little rocky.
Okay.
Like, it kind of swings all over the place.
But make it through to two and
make it through to two
sweet
and three.
Ride.
And it, yeah. It
so is it, are they real characters? If
no.
No. So no. It's
all
fantasy.
Just invented. But every now and again, you'll get, oh, hey, there's DJ Cool Herc, and there's Grandmaster Flash, and they talk about Misty Holloway, and they're, like, they're doing all of this stuff, but they're all, like, sort of.
Is there any hint of South Bronx? South Bronx. Mm-hmm. South Bronx. Mm-hmm. South Bronx.
All the breaks. Yeah. It's really strong.
I can't wait, man.
And there's, I mean, when they have some character says, listen, we gotta go. Your mom's just making the rice and running with the government cheese and the loose meat chili. We got to go. And I'm like, government cheese? You sold me.
I just did a whole fucking Smodcast episode about government cheese. Oh my God, now I have to see it. This, the posters look good, man. I love that era of hip hop, the beginning of hip hop, because I think there's so many rich stories to tell. Look, you can tell the story about, you know, 20 years into hip hop with Straight Outta Compton. Mm-hmm. But like, you know, like the Run DMC story, which is a little bit told in Crush Groove, that's a fascinating fucking story. Like when we had DMC on Comic Book Men, he made his parallels between comics and like, he's like that, the terminology, the very visual terminology we use, like we bust through walls, knock down doors. He's like, that came from comic books. And the I'm number one, I'm the best, I'm the greatest, also came from comic books. So he's got a tight tie to comics. But he sold his collection to buy what? Turntable and microphone. So that they could start Run DMC. So like shit like that, like I would love to watch Run DMC movie, man, origin story. A lot of early hip hop accent, even now of course, but particularly then, like you're talking about the birth of something. Like you said, man, they created something out of fucking nothing. So all of these stories are permutations of the same thing. Pioneers, revolutionaries, stepping out there and being like, wicked, wicked, does that work? Wicked, 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 oh my God, wicked, 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 and bang. So I can't wait.
Yeah.
I
wanna see it. And it's always fun. It's always just, there's this charge you get when you watch a scene where they're creating something. Like when it's Ray Charles, like inventing what I say on the scene. Like, listen, we don't have any more music, we're out of songs, all right, just follow me, do what I do, say what I say. And you see like the band like, yeah, all right, we'll come in on the one, right? Yeah, the one. Like the, we're making it happen as you're watching it.
Right.
And this has a ton of that, of the, holy shit, we're watching this guy invent this right now. We're watching them write this song on the stage. We're watching this dude discover that he's a rapper. Like, he'd always been a poet, he'd always been a wordsmith, but he'd never gotten a microphone, he'd never written a beat, he'd never, like, performed in front of people. And to see that happen for the first time, you're like, oh.
Breathtaking.
All the dreams, all the hopes, all the heart palpitations. It's really good.
Oh, man. Anybody in it that there was a new people?
Mostly
is Baz Luhrmann, he shoot here or over there?
I am not entirely sure, because they spent $120 million on this.
Are you fucking shitting for six episodes?
They spent, well, for the 12, but that's Game of Thrones season one money.
Yeah.
And apparently creating 1976 The Bronx is as difficult as it is to create Westeros. Like, we've got to build all this shit. We've got to, or just go to Detroit and shoot it, because Detroit feels like it's barely a city anymore. But just, like, we got to get trains with graffiti on them. We got to get walls and brick them down. We got to get, like, vast lots with just junked cars.
It took a little money. It took a minute.
It took a minute and a dollar to do that.
$1 million.
Jimmy Smits is in it.
Ooh.
Giancarlo Esposito.
I love him.
Is in it. Grandmaster Flash and DJ Cool Herc are in it.
Wow.
I'm trying to think who else is in it.
Kids are all new.
Kids are all new except for the guy playing Shell in Fantastic.
Excellent name.
Is the best name. Was also in Dope. He was a lead in Dope.
Oh, right on.
Yeah.
So, a big recommend.
Big recommend.
Kids are making out like bandits on Netflix lately.
Yes.
KidCast. Unknowns coming into prominence.
Totally.
With shows that people fall in love with. The Get Down is fairly new, but so is Stranger Things. Mm. But Stranger Things has captured, owns the summer.
It really does.
I mean, you've now watched, I've seen two episodes, I just gotta go deeper. Yeah. I've just been busy. And when Luke Cage happened, I had to watch that first. I'm a Marvel guy. And a DC guy. I'm both.
I'm a comic book guy.
I'm a comic book guy. But I have yet to go deeper on Stranger Things, but I absolutely loved it. Mm. I loved the font, I loved everything about it. It seemed like it was a found TV show of something that was like, oh, we found this in the vaults. This was a show that happened in the 80s. It looks period, people's hair is period, of course, but the way it's shot, these Duffer brothers, man, is geniuses. I asked Mojo, I was like, you think they grew up when we did? Or do you think you can only do something like this out of a sense of reverence and you didn't grow up with it? He's like, my guess is they were babies when these movies were happening.
Yeah, I think so.
And then when they were in their teens, like we went back to the movies of the 70s, they went back to the movies of the 80s, and they fell in love with the genre. And in doing this, telling the story, which is very 80s influence, they just went for all the trappings of it. And it makes all the fucking difference, dude. Even as you're watching the fucking opening credits happen, it just feels period, man.
Yeah, I mean, it's the opening credits are super fucking Carpenter.
Yeah.
Like the music, the fucking synth pop is in there. It's like Stephen King meets Steven Spielberg and just melded into this awesome, like, weaponization of nostalgia. Like,
yeah.
It absolutely knows exactly what you want out of that.
It definitely owes a tip of the hat to Super 8, it feels like.
Yeah.
Like, certainly not the same thing, but, like, JJ feels like he got to that territory, that Goonies explorers territory, like a minute before the Duffer Brothers, and they just did it in a different direction and had a lot more time to do it. And boy, those fucking two episodes I watched were like jaw-droppingly good.
Yeah, I mean, and the fucking cast, those kids are
astounding.
Amazing.
They seem like somebody went through a time portal and grabbed kids from the 80s, normal looking fucking kids and said, all right, go.
Yeah.
And so they can act their asses off, man.
Like, that casting director should now work on everything because whoever that is has got the eye.
That's the... Yes, agreed. If you find a cast that exceptional, that young, has never worked before, like, it's one thing when you see, like, the casting of the Avengers movie, not taking anything away from that casting person, but, you know, famous people. Famous people.
A bunch of movie stars here.
And you can count on them a little bit at the box office. But, a casting director who captures your attention, your imagination, is the one that's like, I found you these kids that the whole world is watching right now. And everyone thinks they're genius actors and stuff, but nobody knows them because I've just brought them to you.
And then, like, cherry-picking people from, like, the ether, like, Winona Ryder. Who should we get? Winona Ryder for this. Get me Matthew Modine for this.
Matthew Modine, two 80s icons as well.
Yeah, and, like, it all holds together so well.
You're five deep in it?
I'm five deep in it. And I'm watching with my son, my 12-year-old.
And it's going well?
It's going well for him, although it's funny to watch because the nostalgia does not work at all on him.
And he's like, why? This song sucks. You're like, are you out of your mind? It's 99 Left Balloons.
Somebody should get a fucking cell phone. Like, yeah, buddy, they had walkie-talkies was the closest to a cell phone that they had, and they're using walkie-talkies.
Oh my God, that's right. All the storytelling elements that are not at your disposal. The kids can't be like, with text on the screen or anything.
There's no, like, Google it. No, you can't Google it. You have to get a CB radio and hope you can talk to the other side. Maybe. Right. Possibly. But yeah, my wife and I are just like in it deep because it is speaking entirely to us. But my son's like, all right, I'll keep watching. This is kind of...
He's like, there's kids in it. I'm a kid.
He's like, oh, I wonder what happened. I think maybe that... Is that another dimension? Maybe? I don't know. But yeah, he's like, I'll watch another one. Sure. Like, he's very tentatively on his way. But while I'm fucking in.
I'm already there.
Yeah,
he's on his way. I'm waiting for him. What do you think it is? Just the gestalt of... Great storytelling told through the particular prism. The gimmick, if you will, seems to be what draws people in initially, but the story is what keeps us all kind of like, we all give a fuck about 11.
Yeah, I mean, I think we give about 11, we care about what happens to Will later on, like what happened to Barb. Mm-hmm. You'll get to what happens to Barb.
Yeah.
I think it's a well-told mystery. It's like a Scooby-Doo writ large, you know, in the best. Scooby-Doo meets E.T., meets Akira. You know, the find me the young.
Oh my God! Good pull, good pull.
You know, just tortured and tested and
the power child
by and there's also this bit, this weirdness of, and it happened a lot in the 80s, but still happens, the fear of the girl on the verge of puberty, the hidden power.
Single. We got some writing coming. Good.
But it was a big Stephen King trope. It's Carrie. It's Firestarter. You know, it's there's another movie coming out next week called Morgan with Kate Mara. But it's all about, it's Hannah. It's Ex Machina. It's what do you do about this woman who's experiencing her womanhood for the first time, and we don't know how to wrestle with this much power.
Right.
Like, it's the male gaze and the feminine power and not knowing what to do with it. And it's a powerful motif. It's an enduring motif. I mean, it's all over Greek mythology. It's Pandora's box. It's like, what do you do when you open this thing that nobody's ever opened before? Oh shit, the world is gonna go nuts.
God damn it, pause, go to a two shot. Jesus. Jesus. You know what I'm saying? You thought you liked Stranger Things, then you hear it through this prism. Back to a single.
But that's at the core of this. The core of this is afraid of the sort of knowledge and wisdom of children. But also afraid of this, oh my God, this girl can do things that nobody's ever seen before. We have to get her back and chain her up and channel her power through the sort of adult male perspective, through the, she needs to be a weapon for us.
Right.
And we want her to be free. The story wants her to be free, to find her own path. And that's amazingly powerful. It's astoundingly powerful, and it's the reason why it endures from decade to decade to decade, from Stephen King to Spielberg to Brian De Palma to everything. Stranger Things, you guys. You should watch this.
Whoa. If that didn't convince you to give it a roll, you got your head up your ass. The whole world's talking about Stranger Things. Why aren't you watching it? You're like, we already have. Get off our dick. Fine. Fair enough. But if you haven't, that will fucking put you in the mood, man. And be like, all right, let me try one. If you try one, you'll try the rest.
Get thee to a streamery, my friends.
Get thee to a streamery. What else we got in the news? Kubo and the Two Strings?
I loved it, man.
You saw it?
I saw it.
In a theater?
In a theater, and like you're supposed to.
This is the Laika people that did Coraline and
Paranorman and the Box Trolls.
Yes. Like, beautiful work. They still do stop motion.
They still do stop motion.
Like actual clay puppets or puppets that aren't clay, whatever the fuck, but like not computer animation.
If there's any computer animation, it's so sparse that you couldn't even pick it out. But the thing I love about this stuff is that it is the definition of movie magic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it is because movies, kids at home, not sure if you know this, it used to be film. It used to be pictures, like 24 frames per second is how movies work. And your mind allows you to forget that they're still pictures. It tricks you into thinking that it's motion. And that's what movie magic is. It's the tricking you into thinking that motion exists out of still frames.
Fucking so eloquent. I'm a filmmaker. And I never even thought of it like that. Well done.
But we forget that because computer animation and digital photography sort of removes and erases those things.
The 24 per second frame rate doesn't really exist anymore. I mean, in a world of 29.99993 frame rates, that's gone too.
Except, you know, when you're doing stop motion, you are still taking those pictures. Each one of those things is click. Move, click, move, click, move. On this scale that is astounding to see, when there's 50 characters in a scene and there's kites flying and there's birds chirping and each one of those things needs to be moved, click, move. And it's movie magic at its realest.
And true artistry.
And true artistry.
Like any jackass can stand in front of a camera and be like, you know, I'm mad because I'm stuck working at Quick Stop all day and stuff. Not to take anything away from Brian Hahn. Here, you've met her. Any jackass can stand there with a backwards baseball cap and say fucking nothing on camera. That's not artful and it doesn't take talent. To make a fucking, what is it called?
No, Kubo and the Two Strings.
To make Kubo and any strings move, it takes craftsmen or womanship and detail-oriented filmmaking that I'm just not capable of. Most filmmakers aren't, to be honest with you.
No, I mean, nobody does this anymore because it's both expensive and time-consuming, and there's easier ways to do it.
Don't tell them that.
I mean...
Laika's like, what? What did he say?
Wait, what? Computers?
They are, you know, they're... You know, just the way Chris Nolan, it's like, I still shoot film.
Yeah.
I won't shoot video. I'm a film guy. Laika is just like, we like doing what we like. This is what we like to do. We put all our heart and soul into this, and we stand next to these movies and proudly. And yeah, maybe they don't light up the world like Pixar, but fuck you, man. Time will tell. It's all about legacy and building a library that we're proud of. And the Laika library is unlike anything else. Thank you very much. So you recommend?
I do. It's a beautiful movie.
What's the story of?
It's a simple movie. It's about this kid who—it's all set in Japan. It's an Asian story, and so this kid whose father died when he was even before he was born, and his mother's been raising him. His father died; he lost an eye. His uncle, grandfather, the Moon King—it's all mythical—stole his eye. Wants his other eye so that he can see into the world of the living. Moon King, kind of a little bit in the dead, but his mother's been protecting him his entire life, keeping him out of the sight of the. He could only go out during the day. Can't go out at night because the moon can see him at night. He'd been following these directions his entire life until he decides he doesn't want to one time, and his mother dies as a result.
What?
Yes.
Kids movie?
Kids movie.
I guess somebody's mother has to die. It's kids
movie. Somebody's mother's got to die. So he then goes on this quest to find his father's armor, which will protect him in the fight against the Moon King. But the power that he has is because his mother was a little bit magic, and his father was a super great samurai warrior, is whenever he plays his little guitar-y thing with his two strings, he can make paper come alive, like origami. And so this movie is all about this guy playing his guitar and this paper just flying in the air, forming dragons and boats and sea monsters and everything. And it's just so lovely. And it's a simple fable. It's a simple quest. Find the armor, defeat my grandfather, and get my life back. Of course, there are twists and turns, and I'm not going to give away the ending, but it's just this lovely fairy tale, just writ large and executed with this artisanal quality to it. Mm. It's just delightful.
You got me buying a ticket. When it came out, like 2 weeks ago?
Two weeks ago.
Did it do well?
It did okay. It did okay. They all do okay. Like, these LEGO movies are never going to be Pixar movies.
It's not about the box office with these films. No.
I mean, but they'll make, I mean, each one seems to make about 90 to 100 million worldwide, and they cost about 40 or 50 million to make.
So they're breaking even, or making a little bit.
And they get to make more, and it seems like that's what this company's about, just being around to make more of them.
Last three things we're going to talk about, and then send you off into that good night to think about the things that Mark has told us today. Runaways is going to be a show on Hulu.
Yes. Did you ever read the book?
No.
The book
by, it's a Marvel book where the kids are...
Yeah, the kids find out that their parents are supervillains. They were basically like raised as rich kids whose parents had stuff.
And did they have a sentinel, a pet sentinel, or is that another book I'm thinking of?
This was the, one of them has a pet dragon, a pet dinosaur, I think.
Interesting.
I want to say. But yeah, Brian K. Vaughan wrote it.
Okay.
Adrian Alfona did the art. And once upon a time, later on down the pike, Joss Whedon took a run on writing it for about an arc or two, I think.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a beautiful book, like a well-felt story, like about kids coming to grips with who their parents are and who they are as a result of who their parents are.
And who their parents are supervillains.
Right.
So it's a little like Wanted, like Mark Millar's Wanted.
A little bit like Wanted, but more like, you know, charting your own destiny separate from your parents. Like, Wanted was very much about embracing who you are,
right,
where this is about trying to discern who you are while dealing with the responsibility of, oh, what if your dad is Lex Luthor? Do you have to grow up to be evil? Or can you take your fate in your own hands?
I like it. It's going to be on Hulu?
It's going to be on Hulu.
Who's running it?
A dude named Josh Schwartz and his partner Stephanie Savage. Josh Schwartz, best known for Gossip Girl.
Did he also do The O.C. or no?
I think he might have also done The O.C.
Wow, right on.
Yeah,
so that's good.
It'll be on the Hulus. They bought a pilot and a couple of scripts, heading towards a series order. And because it is part of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, being produced by the Jeff Loebs and the Marvel folks, who knows?
It is? Yeah. Runaways is? Nice! So,
who knows who they could cross in, cross over, cross off.
Punisher shows up.
Fuck you!
The Tick is happening on Amazon.
It is. I've seen the pilot. The pilot is now streaming on the Amazon.
And?
It's good!
Yeah, yeah.
It's good.
Who played The Tick?
Peter Serafinowicz. Who you will, you'll recognize him the minute you see him, but he is also the leader of the Nova Corps, Nova Squadron in Guardians of the Galaxy.
Oh, the guy from Edgar Wright's stuff?
Yes.
Yes.
That dude.
He was in Shaun of the Dead.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Their third roommate. wow, right on.
Good. Written and directed by Ben Englund.
Does he, really?
Yes.
He created it too.
He created it.
So he wrote and directed it? How awesome is that?
Yeah.
How rare does that happen?
Yeah.
Oh, how cool for him.
And it's kind of fun because I wasn't an overwhelming fan of the other live action show with Patrick Warburton, who I love, but it was so much a sitcom because they could not do the bigness of it in live action. Now they can do the bigness. So there's giant shit that happens in The Tick that you just couldn't do unless it was animation.
Is Chairface Chippendale in it?
Not in this one, but one can only hope.
So you go to Amazon, vote it up, and then you get more.
And then you get more. And they want to make more.
Amazon. I like this company.
Do it.
Buckaroo Banzai. Future home Buckaroo Banzai.
Yeah,
but they can check out
the Buckaroo Banzai.
Yeah, there are good things. We'll talk. The Tick, you can watch right now on Amazon.
Yes.
The pilot.
Yes.
Last thing we're going to talk about. This excites me because I'm like, well, this is a good idea.
Yeah.
Tell them.
The Lost Boys.
So ready for a television show.
Come on.
Easily, you know what I'm saying? And they're gonna do it where?
The CW.
Of course they're gonna do it the CW. Best fucking place for it, man.
Seriously.
And who's gonna be creating it?
Rob Thomas,
of
the guy
course.
Who did iZombie.
iZombie, and he also did the Carrie Diaries, and he
Veronica
also did
Mars.
Veronica Mars. But The Lost Boys, good idea,
come
right?
On.
I can't believe nobody tried this before.
As long as there is an episode, an entire episode devoted to shirtless sax guy.
Yeah.
That's all I want.
And
Sergio.
Think about it, man. They've got, like, that movie was ahead of its time. Those kids were into comic books.
Mm-hmm.
They worked at a comic book store and shit like that. Right now, the finger's on the pulse. So I look forward to that. I think that's a good idea in terms of, like, old movies that you could turn into a TV show. Fuck yeah, I'd watch the shit out of Lost
Boys.
Totally
fits in on the CW.
Fuck yeah, in a world where they're losing the Vampire Diaries, fucking this.
Slide it right in.
Yeah, right? Slide in like a vampire's fang into your jugular. Just to keep it relevant.
I wonder if they'll get Jamie Gertz to come back. Maybe she'll be, like, the old...
What's-his-face, too? Kiefer?
Kiefer could come back.
Could come back.
Jamie Gertz.
Jason Patrick can come back. The old man is gone, right? Edward Mulhare or whatever his name was.
Yeah.
One of the Coreys is still around. Corey could come back. Corey Feldman. Corey Haim, unfortunately, gone. So yeah, you could do a lot of like fucking, hey, it's them, hey, it's them. Like fucking, man, they gotta get Kiefer to play the part of the old guy.
Oh, that would be great.
That'd be fantastic, right? Put him in the button-down sweater and shit like that. We'd all see
Santa Clara, one lovely place to live, it wasn't for all the damn vampires.
Yeah, fucking hey, man. I'm excited, that's a good idea. A lot of good ideas coming at you in the very near future. Yeah. We're happening right now. Stranger Things, man.
Luke Cage soon. The Get Down right now.
Stranger Things and The Get Down right this very second if you want. Kubo in theaters right now.
It. Support some good shit.
Runaways tick right now on Amazon. Mm. At least one. Lost Boys and Runaways got a little bit of a wait.
Yeah, but they're coming.
Yeah, but it's worth waiting. This is the shit we stay alive for. I don't know about you. I'm sure you got families and love in your life. But I stay alive from project to project. I'm like, I just want to die, but I won't. Until I see this Lost Boys on CW.
One more thing to live for.
You string enough of those together, that's what you call a life. Not well lived, but a life. And that's one to grow on.
Thanks, Clarence.
That's all we got time for here on Fat Man on Batman Man. Tune in next time. We'll tell you some more stuff. Till then, I'm Kevin Smith.
I'm Mark Bernardi.
And we'll see you next time on Fat Man on Batman. Same fat time, same fat channel. Spotcast.com or
YouTube.com/Kevin Smith.
Hey man, it's me, Kevin Smith. Thanks for watching. Do me a favor, click that thing below that says subscribe. Every time you click that, you save a baby kitten from murder.
These shows are fucking phenomenal. Luke Cage did not fucking disappoint, man. No. Like, they took a story in a bunch of different unpredictable directions, told it with a filmmaking style that spoke to me as an indie filmmaker. I love the composition. I love the, and this is weird, editing. They actually let some scenes go longer than your knee-jerk editor in you would let it, would cut it out. So many scenes where I'm like, oh, they need to go out there. But they let it go on for just a couple seconds more, and I'm like, I like it, it's nuanced. The other thing they did was something that show Vinyl did that I liked, which was like have a musical number in the middle of it, somebody singing. Now in Vinyl, it was like, you know, a flashbacky thing to a famous artist. Here, Cottonmouth, who's the villain, that's not spoiling it, because they've cast that guy and they said that in the news. He has a club in Harlem that people perform at. And he also, his background, well, I can't spoil that, right?
No, not too much.
But he has a club in Harlem where people come perform. So throughout the show, you have like these wonderful performances like on stage that are usually cross-cut with something heinous going on or something thrilling or something, or an action sequence. Really well done, man. The infusion of music is something that, like, you know, every show has had a score, but this brings, you know, by virtue of the fact that their story's set at a club sometimes, they're allowed to like bring in elements that you haven't seen in other Marvel shows. Elements that you have seen in other Marvel shows that are on full display here. S-E-X.
Oh, yeah.
From the first episode, it's just like, pa-cha-kang, pa-cha-cha-cha-chang. His pants get shimmied down. You see a lot of flesh. Oh, my Lord.
Shimmy, shimmy, shimmy down, shimmy pants.
It is, it's pretty, don't watch it with your kid.
No.
Unless you want to be like,
Or unless you wanted to have the talk, yeah. And you needed a thing to have the talk about.
Why is Luke uncaged? That's his dick, okay?
That is his superpowered dick.
It is, there's some sex in it. But that's what I like about these shows. Like Jason Mewes, guy who plays Jay and My Silent Bob, my fucking male wife, said that one point when he was watching Jessica Jones, he goes, I don't watch that. And a theory about the Marvel Cinematic Universe, the best villains are on their Netflix shows because you got way more time to pull the taffy. Like, think about the Age of Ultron. Your motherfucker was like, I just want to stop things. Tony needs to be punished. And no motivation. He's a computer, whatever, fuck. But they got no time because they're like jamming story down your throat, a lot of action. Here with TV shows, when you got 10, 13 episodes, you can pull that taffy out.
Kingpin is great. David Tennant's Purple Man is great. You know, Cottonmouth is great.
Add to that pantheon now, the performance of Cottonmouth. Like, it is nuanced and rich, and also that's not spoiling, because anybody knows the character. Mariah, like, she's a villain, too. In the comics, she's a massive villain. She's big. But here, she's played by Alpha Woodard, who's not very big at all. But who's big in talent, motherfucker, but not big in waste. But she's another villain. She's also the big bad as well. And she is, like, they got fucking lucky getting her in this thing to play the bad guy. Like, she's fantastic, man. Like, I'm telling you, cast across the boards is dynamite.
Yeah, super strong. So yes, when you can watch, September 30, I believe.
That when it comes out?
They all drop. It's a little sneak preview, still in August. Telling you, the inside dope.
It's worth the wait.
It really is.
And you know, you're wondering, well, you've seen from the trailer, the headband and the cuffs play for at least a beat in the origin story, but there's more.
Oh,
there's
so much more.
Oh, Easter Egg City. It's like Easter when you watch this thing. The eggs just start flying, and you just want to eat them. You know, suck the color off and eat them. That's how you do it, right? That's how you did it in your house, right?
Pretty much, fillet the eggs until all the colors off.
So Luke Cage, man, like, I can't, honestly, my thumbs up, his thumbs up. Andrew's shooting us, his thumbs are up, my thumbs straight up my ass. This show is phenomenal.
Wiggle, wiggle, wiggle.
Yeah, and this, honestly, like, of all of them, now I hold out hope for fucking Iron Fist.
I really do.
Because, like, they fucking nailed Luke Cage. Like, it is really enjoyable, man. A lot of people go, like, hey, it's like modern-day blaxploitation. I didn't feel that at all.
No.
It kind of plays more like The Unforgiven.
Yeah,
like, it's a like dude who's like, I'm done with this.
You know, yeah, The Wire. It's The Wire. It's not blaxploitation. Once again, The Wire.
It is. It's excellent. It's Marvel does The Wire.
Yeah. The Wire was
or does The Wire.
Today on our show!
Stranger Things!
Luke Cage.
And an ass ton of more stuff right now on Fat Man on Batman. Welcome to Fat Man on Batman. I'm Kevin Smith.
I'm Mark Bernardin.
We're here to drop all the news that's fit to print.
Or tape.
Yeah.
Or broadcast, or stream.
And to be fair, it's old news by this point, by the time you're hearing it. But it's news to us.
True, and it's less news, it's more views.
That's true.
Some things we've seen.
And that's why you hang out with Mark Bernardin. He's a writer, goddammit. Mark Bernardin, aside from writing comics and TV and shit like that, is an editor. What is your exact title?
Film editor, the LA Times.
Film editor. Did you hear that? Film editor, LA Times. That's the kind of thing you say at a press conference. Mark Bernardin, film editor, LA Times. Where's the bathroom? Like, it's over there, you fucking... You wasted time at a press conference.
But I've got this hat with press stuck in the brim.
And I have to urinate. Thank you. Now to go.
Pardon me.
We are going to talk this week about a bunch of things. We'll do Stranger Things last. Because everyone's been going like, are you ever going to fucking talk about Stranger Things?
Yes.
Today is that day. But before
dreams
that...
Dreams do come true.
Let's talk a little bit about Luke Cage.
Which he and I, you and I, us, we have both seen the first seven episodes of Luke Cage.
Yeah, that's right.
We are prohibited from speaking at length in detail about what
signed
we saw.
Signed end disclosure agreements, non-disclosure agreements, so that we can't say anything to a certain point. But I challenge this NDA by saying this. It is fucking spectacular.
It really is.
There. I mean, sue me now, Marvel.
I'm sorry I told people your thing was good.
It is fucking dynamite. Here, if I have to rank the Marvel Netflix shows so far, and I don't want to, unless somebody's got a fucking gun to my head.
Rank them.
But I'm a comic book fan. We rank shit. Here we go.
Rank
doesn't make one worse than the other. Personal preferences for me.
Rank them up.
Daredevil season one and Luke Cage are almost shoulder to shoulder. That's how much I love Luke Cage.
Bold strokes.
Right under that, Jessica Jones. Right under that, Daredevil season two. And that's not to say I didn't like Daredevil season two. I liked it a lot. But Jessica Jones is crazy good quality. It's just a way of saying all of that. I binged. I went one after the other, man. Just boom, 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 boom.
And it's got a great sense of place.
Yeah.
Like, you absolutely know.
I mean, community.
Previously, we had seen, like, Hell's Kitchen be kind of Hell's Kitchen-y. This is fucking Harlem.
Yeah, it's uptown. They reference that all the time. They're like, there's some weird things going on downtown.
But up in Harlem, we take care of our own. Mm. And Harlem is totally a character here. And it's definitely, like, the texture of it feels like, it feels real. And it is the blackest show I've seen in a long time.
Even more than Black-ish?
Even more than Black-ish, it's black. It's the
term-ish. Like, if Black-ish is... Blackish.
Yeah, this is.
This is just flat out black.
This is new black.
It's, but not in like black. Don't fucking scare what's left of old white America that ever is watching this. It's awesome.
It's awesome, but it's awesome the way The Wire is awesome. And
yes.
The Wire.
And they cherry picked The Wire cast wise smartly.
smartly.
But it is. It's kind of like Marvel Does the Wire.
It's Marvel Does the Wire.
Good pull.
And it feels very much like that. And I know you old white guys love The Wire, so you will also love this.
There you go. That was a good way in. Listen, old white folks. Remember how thrilled you were by The Wire? It's just like that.
It's just like The Wire.
Except he's bulletproof, which is fucking fantastic. That's whenever so they do a fight sequence, he's just like,
yeah.
And people go flying and shit.
It's the nonchalance. It's just the like, you bother me. Like, okay, fine, I've got to destroy you dozen people
bang.
Again.
I throwing guess. People into ceilings, through windows. Right. Like, they have a, you know, like in Daredevil, the hallway fight and stuff. They have their version of it. It's not so much a one long take, right. But it's Luke. You've seen it in the trailer. Luke entering a place and just decimating.
With the car door pulls off and he's just a battering ram and it's ripping pipes out of the wall and it's so great.
There's lots of that. There's a shot. God, fuck, I want to talk about it so bad. Can't. Yeah.
We fuck.
Can. But there's something straight out of the comic books. Straight. Like in a lot of character names are and stuff. Mm. And the performances, top fucking notch. Alfred Woodard kills. Mm-hmm. Who's the guy who's playing Cottonmouth? I can't pronounce his name.
Mahalal Shabazz Ali.
I always say that's the dude from House of Cards. Mm-hmm. He's fantastic as Cottonmouth. Like, honestly, he's one of the most compelling villains that Marvel's put together. This is my more. And I was like, what do you mean? He's like, I only watched 3 episodes. I don't watch the rest. I said, why? It's awesome. He goes, it's too sexy. There's too much sex. She's always having sex. And I'm like, why are you intimidated by this? He's like, I don't, that's not what I want in my superheroes. But meanwhile, he's watched Luke Cage, and one of the first things he said was, did you see him knock the bottom out? And I'm like, I thought you didn't like superhero sex. It's not an overuse. In fact, I believe he gets laid in the first episode. Yeah, and then
just the one scene.
Well, like, spoilers, I guess.
But it's the one scene.
Oh, it's hot. But anyway, it's not. I don't want you going like, this is all about sex on Luke Cage. Yeah. But it's sexy. Like, it's sexy. Adult. It's like, if only the universe was smart enough to know Marvel beyond Marvel. Like, if they ever knew of Marvel's epic line, they could have called all the Netflix shows Marvel epic, because it's just grown up enough. They don't curse, they find a very ingenious way to not fucking curse a lot in the show, and a very sentimental, nostalgic way of working in with a character. Performances are fantastic across the boards. Mike Coulter, we've seen him go to work as Luke Cage in Jessica Jones. Who you haven't seen up till now is Misty Knight.
Mm-hmm.
Played by Simone Missick. Like, this is an insanely strong female character that has been around in Marvel Comics forever, but they've now added to the Marvel canon in terms of cinematic universe. I guess the TV is included in the Marvel cinematic universe.
Yep.
Like, strong-ass character who could have her own show. In fact, she spends so much time on screen with him, it's almost like their story.
Yeah.
Now, if you know that character from the comics, she got a rich history, man. Like, you know, spoilers, this don't happen in the series. I'm talking about comic books now. But Misty Knight, like, loses her arm. She gets a bionic arm that Tony Stark builds for her and shit. And she goes on to date who? Not Luke Cage, but
Daniel Rand.
Spoilers. Iron Fist. She gets iron fisted. Can you believe that shit?
But so she's got the metal arm.
Yeah, he's getting iron fisted. He's like, that's why they call me that. Ooh, that's why I wear the scarf to keep my brains in when I get iron fisted by my girl with the bionic arm. That's why they don't let us do these shows. And now they're not going to let us watch these shows anymore either.
So you want to watch the first 7? No. No, you can't.
Oh, my God.